I want to start with a little shout out to Sabbath School. If you were here in Sabbath School in this building, could you say amen?
Amen.
Okay. Sabbath School was awesome. Seriously, I couldn't have given a better illustration for the message last night. God meets people where they are. We meet people where they are. It was so cool. Church planting, house churches, motorcycle ministry. I mean, that's what it's all about. So I just wanted to say, God sometimes brings a program together. People don't even know what anyone else is doing, and yet God can bring it together. And that was a beautiful illustration. So I know God's here, and I know that he has a message for you this morning, and it may not be the one I'm giving, but that's the kind of God we have, you see, because he's going to make it happen. Have you ever been so embarrassed that you wish the ground would just open up and swallow you? Wow, that was quite a reaction. I think we're touching reality here, because I know that feeling very well. I remember when I was 19 years old. I told you last night that I was a rather strange child. That's true. Another one of the strangest is by the time I was 11 years old, I was a church organist. So that's really strange. Can't say I did it all willingly, but you know, it happened. So anyway, so I became quite interested in organ, and if you're all into organ music, when I was 12, my father dragged me kicking and screaming to Lincoln Center in New York City to hear a concert by some guy named Virgil Fox. Didn't realize that that was historic, because Virgil Fox, you know, is the name above all names in that field. But he left a successor, the Riverside Church in New York City, a man named Frederick Swan, who also in his own generation achieved tremendous renown. And one Sunday morning, I had some friends, and I said, you got to hear the organ at Riverside. It's the greatest classical pipe organ in the United States. And Frederick Swan's going to be playing. It's going to be awesome. And it was. You know, they had 64-foot pipes on the back wall. You know, so when those things got going, you thought it was an earthquake. Oh, that's right. It wasn't California. Anyway, so we attended the service, and at Riverside, I was never able to sing a hymn because the music was so powerful and uplifting that it just, you know, took all the wind out of me. When the service was over, they left the organ open up on the platform. People were allowed to come up and sort of have a look at it. It had 5 manuals and 800 stops. And anyway, pretty awesome stuff. So I was up there looking at it, you know, fascinated with the organ. And I was telling my friends some things, you know, well, this is that part of the organ, and this is that, and here's how this works, and so on. And, you know, it's pretty cool for a 19-year-old. And then some more people came up. So I continued explaining about the organ. And more people came up. The crowd was beginning to build. And so I went a little bit past my knowledge to keep the audience, you know. Any of you ever do that? And suddenly I realized they weren't looking at me anymore. They were looking behind me. And I turned around this close to the face of Frederick Swan. And he said to me, you better get your facts straight, sonny boy, before you open your mouth. Turn around and walked out. At that moment, if the ground had opened up, I'd have jumped in. Okay? That was one of life's most embarrassing moments. What does it mean to be real? What does it mean to be authentic? To be transparent, true to duty as a needle to the pole? What does it mean when the outside and the inside are the same? What does it mean to reveal our true selves? The reality is, faking it is the easiest thing in the world. Creating an image is natural. I remember a class I taught at the seminary. There was a fellow in the back row. It was a group of pastors. It was actually a doctoral class, and he had some pretty hefty people in there. And he kept talking about them. You know what he was talking about? Church administrators, conference, union, general conference. The trouble with the church is them. And it didn't seem like 1 hour went by when he didn't raise his hand and had another complaint about them. Because it was a class on how to administer churches and conferences and things like that. So finally, I was a little bit tired of it. And I said to him, you know, people with a doctor of ministry degree are going to be the first in line for church leadership positions in the future. So the question I have for you, how will it be any different when you become one of them? I can hardly believe it, but it's true. 2 weeks later, the phone rang. It was him. He says, you're not going to believe this, but they just named me vice president of one of the larger conferences in North America. And I said, well, I said, this is your chance to show how it's done. And a couple of years later, I heard that he had been named president of a medium-sized conference. And then the day came. We were on the same general conference committee. About 50 people on the committee, so you know, it's being on it is not that special. But we were on the same committee. I was looking forward to seeing him again. And I came into the room, about 50 people in the room, and I was looking around, where was he? And there I saw on the other side of the room. And I hollered his name, and I ran across the room, ready to give him a high five. And he turned around. He had on a three-piece suit. His elbow was permanently attached to his side, and he put his hand up, hello, John. So nice to see you again. And I couldn't believe it. He had become one of them. You see, faking it is so natural. I knew him. I knew all the evil that lurked in his heart as a student, you see. But we can't be real because we're supposed to be the people of God. We've got to be perfect. We've got to do everything just right. We can't afford to let anything slip. Why is it so natural to fake it? It's because we're afraid to be real. We're afraid to show who we really are. Why? Because we're afraid of what other people will think. What will they think of me, camp meeting speaker, if they see me in shorts in the breakfast room? What will they think? What will they think if the hair isn't just right? How will they respond? Now, psychologists know all about this. They call it defense mechanisms. Defense mechanisms are what people do to protect the inner self. And particularly if at some point in you've experienced, you've been harmed by another person, or worse yet, even harmed by the church. It's very, very easy to protect something deep, deep inside and never let it out. Never let anyone see it. Let me illustrate what defense mechanisms are like. One of my favorite baseball players was Randy Johnson. Oh, Seattle, huh? Oh, I was wondering if anybody here knew him. That's right. That's right. If you know Randy Johnson, say amen. Okay, so we're on the turf. You see, because Randy Johnson was awesome. He was 6'10". And he had a 101 mile an hour fastball. And he had this long hair that he would wash like once a month. You know? And it was just kind of, it was just, there was a bit of ugliness about him, you know? And he got up there and he would just kind of, and the batters would kind of just, can I bat from the dugout, please? Doesn't work very well in baseball, you see. Now, just imagine, Randy Johnson's here today. And he's standing right in the middle of the auditorium. And he's just taking an offense at my description of his hair. And he decides to launch a 101 mile an hour fastball at my nose. How will I respond? Am I going to say, Randy Johnson has just launched a 101 mile an hour fastball at my nose. Defensive measures would be appropriate. See, by that time, my face is smashed. Doesn't work that way. You see, you don't have to think about it at a moment like that. The moment you see his arm in motion and his eyes fixed on you, you don't have to think about it. You don't have to plan it. It's automatic. It happens because God has designed us to protect that which he has given us, to protect our bodies, protect our face, protect our eyes. And that very tendency toward self-protection is also there emotionally and psychologically. When somebody comes along and says something about us that's just not quite what we'd like to hear, when we feel under attack, when there's a tone of voice, a scowl, the look of an eye, that defensiveness rises up, and you don't plan it, you don't think about it, it happens naturally, it happens unconsciously. The Bible talks about this. It's in Jeremiah chapter 17 and verse 9. Jeremiah 17 and verse 9. Because it puts the diagnosis right on the money. Jeremiah 17, 9 says, the heart is what? Deceitful above all things, and desperately wicked, who can know it? The heart is more deceitful than any other thing. It is so deceitful that nobody even knows how deceitful it is. Whose heart? That's my heart. That's your heart, this is talking about. That's our hearts. The reality is our hearts deceive us. And we don't even realize how deceived we are because it's natural, it's unconscious. We don't plan it. We go around shaping an image. We go around avoiding fastballs. It's who we are. It's what we do. Well, if that's the case, so what? Who cares? Right? If we can't do anything about it, then why even talk about it? Why are you wasting my time this morning? You see? If all of us have a tendency to this. Because inauthenticity is destructive. It's very destructive. We need to know it, we need to identify it, we need to do something about it. Inauthenticity, the lack of being real, is destructive to our witness. We've been talking a lot this week about reaching out. We've been talking about sharing faith. We've been talking about witness. The most destructive thing when it comes to witness is inauthenticity. If somebody's out there with a painted on smile and say, I love Jesus, I'll tell you something. The secular generation can smell inauthenticity a mile away. They can smell an inauthentic church from across the street. They may not know what the problem is, but they know it's there. I remember when I handled a youth group once. Everybody got to do something in their life they're not good at. But I was in charge of the youth group at my local church. And one day I just thought, let's have a discussion. And I raised the question. I said, what is the one thing that would keep you from staying in the church when you grow up? What is the one thing that would make that difficult to stay in the church when you become an adult? I couldn't believe it, what the kids came up with. They went in small groups, they discussed it for a while, and they all came back with the same thing. Do you know what it was? People who act as if they have no faults. See, we'd have thought it was the opposite. It's the faults of the church that are driving them away. It's the mistakes of the church that are driving them away. No, they said, it's people who act as if they have no faults. Because you see, these kids were growing up in homes. They knew what these elders were like. They knew what these deacons were like. They knew what the pastor was like at home. And when home and church are not the same thing, church isn't real. They knew that. They said the toughest thing to overcome is people who act as if they have no faults. So you see, being real is critical to witness. It's critical to our salvation. Because what is it that saves us? If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. What is confession? It's telling the truth about yourself. That's what confession is. To be inauthentic, to build an image, is not to tell the truth about yourself. If we confess our sins, if we tell the truth about ourselves, if we are willing to be real, He forgives our sins and cleanses us from all unrighteousness. Because you see, if God only forgives the sins that are exposed, and the stuff that we hide is the stuff that destroys. Marriage, relationships, inauthenticity kills. Those little things that you ignore, that build up and build up and build up, and one day explodes. Inauthenticity destroys relationships. Inauthenticity destroys our finances. Ask somebody, how much money do you spend in an average month? And the answer is, I don't want to know. That's inauthenticity. Somebody once said, the cost of living is whatever you make plus 10%. And I found that's pretty true. If you're not authentic about money, if you're not keeping track, if you're not budgeting things, you'll end up spending about 10% more than you make. That's simply the way the human psyche works. Inauthenticity destroys our finances, and of course, inauthenticity destroys our health. I can eat whatever I want. I can drink whatever I want. I can smoke whatever I want. If it does anything to me, it'll be at the other end of life, not this end. That's inauthentic thinking. It's not real. You see, authenticity is crucial to health, whether it's physical health, financial health, relational health, spiritual health, witness. Authenticity is critical. So now we've got a problem. We have a heart that deceives us. It deceives us to the degree that none of us even knows how deceived we are. And yet, we need to come to reality in order to be healthy, spiritually, mentally, physically, relationally. So how do we get this authenticity thing? If I'd have had more time, I'd have told you another three or four stories on me. The 19-year-old story, that's okay, you know, that's a long time ago, way back in another century. But I could tell you stories about every 10 years of discovering inauthenticity. I remember a preacher who just cut me to the heart. His sermons were so powerful that it was like reading Ellen White at her very best. And I said, he's not a prophet. He's not even claiming to be a prophet. How is he reading my soul? And suddenly it dawned on me. 90% of his illustrations were from his own experience. And all of them were of his failures, not of his successes. And I thought about my own sermons and I realized my personal illustrations were always about my successes and never about my failures. That was sort of mid-career wake-up call to realize I'd been a preacher for 17 years and I was still pasting an image on. You see, how do we deal with this? Jeremiah 17, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? Obviously, the bottom line there is getting to know your heart. This is the reaching in part of the weekend. Getting to know your heart. Opening yourself to the truth about yourself. But how do you do that if every fiber of your being is trying to cover it up? And I'll tell you, even when I think I'm not covering it up, sometimes I am. So how do we deal with that? I think I can preach on the subject because I've had lots of experience. For nearly 50 years, I've been aware of this problem. I've learned a few things in those years, and I want to share them with you this morning. There are some things we can do because the Holy Spirit, as it said in our reading, the Holy Spirit is there to reveal God's truth to us. Jesus said, it's better for you if I go away, because if I go away, the Spirit will come to you. In the book of Hebrews, chapter 4 and verse 12, it says, the Word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and spirit, of joints and marrow, discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. You see, the Holy Spirit knows what's going on inside of me, even if I don't. It says, no creature is hidden from his sight, but all are naked and exposed to the eyes of him to whom we must give account. The Holy Spirit knows the truth, even if I don't. So how do I plug into that? First of all, I suggest what the text just said, the Word of God, the Bible. But how to read the Bible? Let me make a suggestion. You may want to make notes on this, some of you. You may find this helpful. For reading the Bible, I suggest you read the stories of the Bible. Read about the Bible characters. And you know what you'll discover when you read about the Bible characters? They were a mess. In producing the Bible, God didn't give us perfect saints. There was Peter, and there was David. You think you've got issues? Raise your hand. How many of you have murdered 201 innocent people yet? Thankfully, I'm not seeing any hands. If you haven't murdered 201 innocent people yet, then there's hope for you, because David did. Now, he killed more people than that in battle and stuff, but these were not battle deaths. These were innocent people. These were terrorist acts, like Uriah the Hittite. If David's in the Bible, he's an inspired writer. Peter is an inspired writer. Paul had his moments. Moses, you go through there, some pretty messed up people. I'm not even going to tell you the story of Esther. You wouldn't believe what the Hebrew says if I told you anyway. But there are some serious issues with Bible characters. And if you're one of those people who knows and loves the writings of Ellen White, one of my favorite passages is found in Volume 4 of the Testimonies, pages 9 to 11. Do write that down. Fantastic. Volume 4 of the Testimonies for the Church, pages 9 to 11. It's the first three pages, actually, so easy to find. And basically, she says, God could have made the Bible so that these were perfect saints to be a model for us. But he didn't do that. When people write biographies, they either put people up on a pedestal or tear them apart. Because the Bible does neither. It tells the truth about people's lives. And what happens when you read the truth about other people's lives is you realize, first of all, they're messed up too. So it's okay for me to be honest about my messed up. It's okay to recognize that you're messed up, because the Bible characters were messed up. And number two, if God could use them, if God could use David and Peter and Esther and Moses, if God could use them, there's hope for me. And she says, the Bible's designed such a way when you read those stories, you have the courage to get up from where you've fallen and try again. You know, see, sometimes we use the Bible to discourage ourselves even more. Read the Bible, looking for those encouraging stories of how God used messed up people. And it's the gospel of Jesus Christ that brings the courage to us. Because when we realize that God would rather go to the cross than lose you, what does that say? You're pretty important. As messed up as you may feel this morning, God has some big plans for you. He died for you. See, that gospel message is at the core, because when we realize how valuable we are to God, then we begin to become willing to maybe take a look inside and see what's actually going on. So, reading the Bible's an important step in developing inauthenticity. But through the years, I've discovered limitations to that approach. Because I find it easy sometimes to read what I want to see in the Bible, you know? Have you ever been reading the Bible, and after about 15 minutes, it dawns on you, you've read two or three pages, and you can't remember a thing you've read? They call that defense mechanisms, okay? There's something in there that you don't like, slip right over it. There's Bible texts I've studied as a scholar for 50 years. Well, not that long, maybe 30, okay? And it's only in the last year or two, I thought, ooh, that's what the text is saying. I completely blew right over that. You see, so even in reading the Bible, we have a tendency to see what we want to see. So I've learned that I have to go a little bit deeper in this authenticity thing. And what I've learned to do is what I call authentic prayer. And what is authentic prayer? It goes something like this. Lord, I want the truth, no matter what the cost. I remember the day I really faced that question. It was a few decades back. I was still new in the ministry. And the man who led me to Jesus Christ called me up and said, it's time to leave the Adventist church. He says, because the Adventist church is rejecting the gospel. You have to choose. It's the church or it's Jesus. Now, when your mentor tells you that, you're in crisis. And I remember lying face down on a wooden floor in Brooklyn, New York, pounding that floor with my fist and saying, God, what do you want me to do? And he spoke to me that day, not in an audible voice. I've never heard one of those. If you have, you might want to keep it to yourself. I've never heard an audible voice, but I knew that God was in my mind giving me this message. And he said to me on that day, he said, the disciples never left Judaism. Luther never left the Catholic Church. And Ellen White never left the Methodist Church. They were all thrown out. And he said, that's my plan for you. Don't worry about where you're going to end up. Just be real. Tell the truth as you understand it. Don't change it to please anybody. Don't be obnoxious, of course. But he said to me, I want you to speak the truth as you understand it. And let the chips fall where they may. If they throw you out, then you know that I have something better in store for you. And I have to be honest with you, in the atmosphere of those times, I wondered if I was going to last very long. And you know what I've discovered? The Seventh-day Adventist Church is filled with people who are hungry for authenticity, who are hungry for the truth. They want people to be straight with them. They don't want image casting. They want a faith that's going to make a difference in this world. They want a faith that is real. And instead of being thrown out, I've simply been given more and more opportunity to share because of that. And I thank God for that. Face down on that floor, I said, Lord, I want the truth no matter what the cost. Truth can cost you. It can cost you your job. It can cost you your reputation. It can cost you your family. It can cost you your life. But the truth is worth it all. It is worth it. And if you're willing to pray that prayer, you will pay the price, but you will also get the truth. That's what God did for me that day. But you know what? I've learned that there's some limitations even to that approach, to authenticity. Because, don't raise your hand, have you ever lied to God in prayer? Did you ever walk in the door of the church ready to punch somebody in the nose, you know? And somebody comes up and says, oh, so-and-so isn't here. Would you come up and do the prayer right now? And what did you do? You ran right up there with a big smile on your face and said, Lord, we love you this morning. It's so good to be together with the saints. So I've discovered that I'm capable of lying to God, even in prayer. So authentic prayer is an important component, but I've learned I need to go a little deeper than that. So the next step in inauthenticity that I discovered was journaling. And journaling is kind of keeping a spiritual diary. Ellen White did this. Many of the great saints throughout church history have done this, keeping a diary. And one of the things I like to do is just say, Lord, how are things going? How am I treating my wife? How am I treating my children? How's it going in class and all the rest of that? And then just start writing. First half page, maybe nothing, but somewhere down the bottom of the page, suddenly, whoa, we're getting into some stuff I wasn't thinking about. I find the very process of writing, you see it, you feel it, you hear it, that the whole process of writing seems to draw out from me things that I wasn't thinking about. And God can open my mind to stuff that I might otherwise have missed. Journaling is wonderful. Have you ever finished the prayer and just had a blank sheet of paper and just waited and written down whatever came to your mind? When you're in the attitude of prayer, when you've read the scriptures and put yourself in God's hands, God can speak to your mind and to your heart and open up possibilities. Test them out. You know, because there's other voices in your head. Trust me, I know. But you've got a chance to talk to you. You see, so journaling is a powerful, wonderful way to dig deeper into what's really going on. And God will tell you about flaws in your relationship with your spouse or flaws in your relationship with the kids and so on. He'll open that up to you if you allow him to. But there's even limitations to that. I remember one day I was journaling and the thought came to me, what if you were to die tonight and everybody in the world gets to read this journal? So I made some editorial changes, you know? This inauthenticity thing, you know, it gets after you. It's amazing. So I said, well, okay, journaling's good, but I need to go deeper. And that's when I discovered Authentic Prayer, the sequel. Authentic Prayer 1 was, Lord, I want the truth, no matter what the cost. Right. Authentic Prayer 2 was, I want the truth about me, no matter what the cost. I want to see myself the way other people see me, no matter what it costs. And that's where you get into this Hebrews 4 stuff. You know, this little sword sort of ranging around in there. Painful stuff. Ellen White writes about it in Steps to Christ, page 64 and 65. You probably know the statement. The closer we come to Jesus, the more clearly we see the defects in other people's characters. You know that statement, huh? That's the way we'd like to read it. The reality is, the closer you come to Jesus, the more clearly you see the defects in your own characters. I need to read that every day, you see. Because it's when you're feeling your defects, you think that you're apart from God. You think you're not doing anything of value for God. It's when you're feeling your defects that you're actually close to God. Because the Holy Spirit brings a sense of those defects, but also brings you the encouragement to do something about it. And authentic prayer, too, is painful, but it makes a huge difference. But of course, like any other form of prayer, it is still possible for our heart to lie to us. And I've discovered I need to go deeper yet. And what else could there be, right? We've gone through scripture, prayer, journaling, more prayer. There is one more step on the road to authenticity, and that's called accountability. Accountability. Because you see, we may be the last to know how we come across to others, but they know. They know. Other people, particularly family, knows the defects. They live with them. They suffer from them. And I've discovered accountability is just wonderful. Let's imagine you've decided you want to jog, okay? I'm gonna start jogging. What are the chances you're going to get up at 6 in the morning and go jogging the next day? For most people, pretty slim. But let's say you get together with a friend and you say, okay, I'm going to meet you on that street corner at 6 in the morning. We're going to go jogging. Are you going to be there? Yeah, because you don't want to disappoint your friend. What you may not realize, the only reason they're there is because they don't want to disappoint you. So accountability helps us to do stuff that we wouldn't otherwise do. It's wonderful. So one thing I like to do is get together with people and say, you know, I've decided I want to pray at 7:15 in the morning. That's actually, church is actually recommending that, you see. Would you hold me to accountable to that? What I love is hard-nosed friends. You know what a hard-nosed friend is? Somebody you say, hey, I want to pray at 7:15 in the morning. Will you hold me accountable to that? The hard-nosed friend is going to call you at 7:17. Did you do it? I need that kind of friend. There are some men in my life. I think of one who lives in Iowa. He weighs about 300 pounds, way bigger than me. He's not afraid of me. I made a pact with him. I said, you can tell me anything, anytime that I need to know. And he's not afraid of me one bit. He can just get right in it. You see, I have several friends like that. And best of all, I have to tell you, I am so fortunate. My wife is one of those. Amen. Some of you are cringing a little bit inside. But that's the reality. We have come through 40 years of marriage to care so deeply about each other that we're not willing to say one single unkind word unless it's really needed. And I'll tell you, my wife is the best critic of my sermons. And if she is really excited about a sermon, I know that it worked. You see? And if she's not so excited, I know that she's not alone. But she's willing to share. And I've given her that permission. Ladies, if you haven't been given that permission, I'm not giving it now, okay? Understand me. Don't quote me and say, yeah, he said I could tell you this. No. But if you are a person that can be trusted with the truth, your husband, your spouse will open up to you and be willing to share. And I treasure that, to have someone that I've spent my whole life journey on, that I can open up my heart and tell the truth. Now, men often go a step further, and that's where you get accountability people that you give permission to them to slam into you whenever they think you need it. Those are the best relationships. That is totally awesome. I find women generally are not too excited about that. Another woman comes up and says, you know, yeah, you should see yourself in a mirror. Well, boy, I can hear about that for 2 weeks. You see, that's not good, okay? So women are a little uncomfortable with that. But you know how women get the authenticity thing? It's about getting in a small group where people start sharing what's on their heart. And little by little, one will say something, I'm struggling with my kids today. You know, I remember my wife in one of these groups asked a friend of hers, how are things going? She knew that the in-laws were over, you know, we were staying with them that weekend. How are things going? She said, fine. The mask was strong, but it only lasted a half a second, you see. And that's beautiful. When people open up themselves, what are all the others thinking? Oh, I'm struggling that same way too. Hey, together we can conquer this. You see, authenticity is driven, I think, to a strong degree. And I'm challenged sometimes by what we call prayer meeting and prayer groups, where we're talking about our neighbors, third cousins, in-laws who have cancer or something, you know? Prayer groups are about drawing heart to heart. It's about authenticity. And when authenticity happens in prayer groups, they are powerful beyond belief. But when prayer groups simply feed inauthenticity, I want to run away. So authenticity is so critical. And I have to go one step further. Because I know in any group this size, there's going to be someone here, and probably more than someone, who says, I don't have any friends. There's 3,000 people in here. There's not one that I could truly open my heart to. I don't feel safe with anybody in this world. There is nobody that I would let say anything to me. If you're in that situation now, there is a way. And it's a way we haven't always favored as Seventh-day Adventists. But I think we're beginning to realize our need for it. It's called counseling. It's called therapy. Because what is a counselor? A counselor is simply someone who's trained to listen and be honest with you. They're trained to do that. If you don't know anybody, if you don't have any friends, the counselor is trained and paid to be your friend. And they do it well. People have felt, oh, share your problems only with God. But you've seen all the challenges that that limitation can bring when it comes to authenticity. And I'm reminded of a statement in Desire of Ages, page 297. And that statement basically says, there are people whose eyes are so blinded with tears, who are so burdened with infirmities, that they cannot grasp the unseen, with a capital U. That's God. There are people who cannot come to God because of tears, burdens, infirmities. To such, someone else coming in Jesus' stead, putting one hand in Jesus' hand and the other hand in theirs, can bring the two together. That's what counseling's all about. That's what godly friendship is all about. That's what accountability is all about. There are people who don't know how to bring it to God. They need a face. They need a real person. They need you and me to be real with them so that they can be safe to be real with us. All the hiding, all the faking, all the inauthenticity is rooted in a lack of self-worth. It's rooted in the sense that I'm not good enough, that I will never be good enough. And the beautiful thing is, your value is written in blood. Your value is unbelievable. If you rate yourself based on the chemicals in your body, you're worth about $20. That's not much. But if you're valued in terms of a job, people might say, hey, I'm worth $50,000, $100,000 a year. If we really value people like athletes, you know, Tiger Woods or Michael Jordan, people like that, we value them like $100 million a year. And then there's the software nerd who wrote the software that runs most of our computers. We value him at $100 billion. You know, people are valued for different things that they bring to others. Well, how much are you worth? Way over Bill Gates. You are worth this much. Because Jesus Christ made the entire universe. And the entire universe includes every Harley Davidson and every BMW in existence. That's a part of how much you're worth. He created the mountains. He created the seas. He created the planets, the galaxies. When Jesus Christ died, that's the kind of value that was placed upon us. And in fact, we are told that he would have died just for you.
That's right. Amen.
And if he would have died just for you, that's how much you are worth. And I have to tell you, you can know that intellectually, and it may still be a few days, weeks, years, and even decades before it sinks into your heart. I think I knew how Jesus valued me for a good 20 years before I felt it in my heart. But know it this morning. That's a start. Know how much you are worth. And if you are worth that much, then you need to be real. Why cover up something that's of universal value? Why hide a diamond in the rough? I'm worth the whole universe to him. And you need to understand, if I, John Pauline, am worth the entire universe to Jesus, then I no longer care what you think. You get that? It doesn't matter what you think of me if that's the value he places on me.
Amen.
Those people you're afraid of, people you're afraid of being open with, it doesn't matter what they think.
Right.
Compared to Jesus,
Amen.
It doesn't matter. And we can begin a journey toward honesty and true reality. folk, we want to reach out to Seattle. We want to reach out to the whole Puget Sound region. But I'll tell you this, the church that will make a difference in this secular community will be a church where the people are real. Nothing else will manage it. It's no easy task. I've spent my whole life on this journey, and I'm still going forward. And I want you to join me on that journey if you haven't already. Let's get real. Because that is what Jesus was when he was here. And he calls us to get real with him. May God grant that we come to know each other more deeply than ever before. And that in reaching in and developing a community, a genuine community, he will give us what we need to reach out. May God be with you to that end. Amen.
Amen.